one of the most famous verses in the Bible, it's probably the most famous, John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, and that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." That's the truth of the Bible. That's the crux of the Bible. That's the message that he has for us, and that's the message that he has for us as a church to take for those that we encounter in our week. We may encounter people that don't know this truth or haven't experienced the power of his resurrection in our family today at our outings. Certainly as we go about our week, we'll encounter people who are not made new, who are still carrying around the burden of their past and of their mistakes, and they haven't experienced a love so great from God that he was willing to give up his son, and then a power so great that once his son was dead, he was able to raise him to life again. And they haven't experienced what that means in their life, that it gives them an opportunity to become new, gives them an opportunity for eternal life, an eternal relationship with God and with Jesus Christ. That is the truth of the Word of God. And that's the message of part one of our message, that God loves us even in our faults, so much so that he gave his only son to overcome them, so that we can have a relationship with him. That's the message for each of us this morning, if we still are grasping to understand that, and that's the message that we take away as a church as we go away from this Easter morning. And now, as if that wasn't enough, if this God giving up his son for us out of his love for us wasn't enough, I want to point to another amazing truth of the Bible, is that God is there longing for us, even a people who are so spotted with our faults and have rejected him time after time, yet he's still longing for us to experience his love and his son and what he did for us, so that we can have an eternal relationship with him. I want to go to Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8 that Jonathan read earlier. And it gives us a beautiful picture of that. And we'll go right to the verse 7 for time's sake. Now God, again, this is Mark's account of what we've already read from Luke. And it's the same thing. The men are there and they tell the women that Jesus has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. And then they tell them to go tell Jesus' disciples. And specifically it says, and go tell Peter about this. Go tell Peter that Jesus has risen from the grave. This is obviously God speaking through his angels to the women. And if you think about what we just talked about, how much burden Peter was under, how many mistakes he had in that huge mistake of denying God's own son in his time of need three separate times. Yet here God is saying, go tell the disciples they don't need to be in the pit, and go make sure you tell Peter, the guy who is under the heaviest burden, the heaviest weight, that it doesn't matter anymore because my son is alive again. God wants his disciples, he wants Peter especially, to know that as soon as possible, that God has risen, or that Jesus has risen from the grave. What a beautiful picture of the God we serve, that he specifically mentions Peter, mentions to go tell Peter, the guy that has screwed up more than any of them, that it doesn't matter anymore. I don't know. Okay. God says, you go and make sure Peter that knows that his mistakes of his past don't matter anymore. That God, and this is a picture of a God that doesn't want to leave us where we are. He doesn't want to leave us in the pit. That he longs to meet us where we are. What a beautiful God we serve. The final thing that I want to leave us with this morning is one of the most famous verses or stories in the Bible, and it's known throughout the world, not even just the Christian world. I put that one in there as well. We didn't read it because we're not going to go through the whole thing just for time's sake, but it's the story of the prodigal son, and it's a beautiful illustration of the relationship between us. We're, of course, the prodigal. We're the son. that goes away and rejects the Father and burns our inheritance, and burns what we've been given, and God is the Father. So in this story, of course, we all know it. The Son insults the Father. He takes his inheritance while the Father is still alive. He goes off to the foreign land, the Las Vegas of his time, and he blows the entirety of his wealth, of his inheritance. Now the Son is in the pit, just like Peter. He's down there, he has no money, he's begging for food, he's living on the streets, trying to get food from the pigs that he's feeding. And he decides, we'll pick up in verse 20, that he would go home, and he would beg his father not to be considered a son again, not that he would be accepted back to the life he once had, because he thinks that his past is too great. There's no way the Father, there's no way God could ever accept him back as a son. But verse 20 says, the son got up and went to his father. But while the son was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with anger and rejection for his son. No, it says that he was filled with compassion for him. And the father got up and ran to the son, threw his arms around the son, and kissed him. There is so much depth and beauty to this entire passage, and shameless plug, we're going to explore it more in 2 weeks when I get to speak, when Jonathan's on his honeymoon, May 5th and May 12th, so you can come back for that, but we'll spend the 2 weeks on that. But I just want to point out this one truth through it, and because it's been speaking to me these last few weeks as I prepared for this, and it's the heart of God. God is, not only did he prepare a way for us with the cross and with the resurrection, but Luke 15 tells us here that he is longing for us. He's watching for us, and he sees us when we're still a long way off. And he doesn't come to us in anger and in rejection and scold us, slap us on the wrist. Yet he runs to us with compassion. He runs to us with love. And the son really didn't do anything but turn back towards God. Because the son doesn't speak an apology. He doesn't even get to the father. He doesn't ask for forgiveness. He just turns to the father. And the father meets him where he's at. We serve a God that is willing and able to meet us where we are at today. And he's willing to meet the people that we encounter in our life where they're at as well. No matter how great their past mistakes are and their past faults. What Jesus Christ has done on the cross is sufficient for all of it. All of the world's evil, if they just turn towards him. And his love is never ending for all of those people, even in their faults, each and every one of us. It's not anything that we do. It's all what Jesus did at that empty grave. So I'm asking you today, of course, if you're not turned towards God, to turn towards him and let him meet you in love. Let him meet you where you are at. But if, as a church, if we meet people today and we have the opportunity or in the days to come, share this truth of Jesus Christ with them, with a hurting world that is longing for love and longing for a God that we have displayed here in the scriptures. A God that is just waiting and longing for us to turn around and come to him so he can greet us with love and say, you are alive, but now you are dead. You are made new, and your past no longer matters. I don't hold that against you. And this last song, I'm sure, will be unfamiliar to us because it's a recently released song, and it hasn't even been a single on the radio yet, but it's actually based off of this story of the prodigal son, and it just beautifully illustrates this picture of a God that runs to us. Even though we run away from him, as soon as we turn to him, he comes running to us in love. So if you're able, we'll stand and sing our last song, which is called Even When You're Running by Casting Crowns. And just let the truth of this song penetrate your heart and soul as we go forth on this Easter morning. If you stand, and I'll get it ready here.
Do you feel? calling with a voice you never heard, but it sounds like home. You try to shut it out, but you feel it in your bones, and it won't leave you alone. His love is inescapable, his presence is unshakable.
Garden to the cross, he's been chasing after each of us. God made a way for us people filled with burdens and mistakes, and the people that we'll encounter in the coming days. He came a way to us, to, even in our faults, to come to him, and he can greet us in love and compassion. And God longs to pour out that love on us and the world today. But only we as individuals can make that decision. but we can be the light for Jesus Christ as a church today, as we go forth and we meet people and we share this love, a love that will not end, a love and compassion that is will meet the worst of us right where we are. And with that, I'm going to pray, and then we'll dismiss for the rest of the sunrise service. Dear God, we thank you as a church and as individuals for what you did, what your Son did for us on the cross. Thank you for his resurrection and that he was willing to bear the entirety of our burden and our mistakes and our past and our evil and our sins. He's willing to take that on, and not only did he take it all on, but he overcame it all when he walked out from that grave on that Easter morning. We thank you also for you're a God that is longing to share that with us, to share your love, to pour it out over us, that we see, just like Peter, who is burdened with all his past, that you didn't want to leave Peter there, and you don't want to leave us down in that pit either. We thank you for the truth of your word that gives us the picture of who you are as a God that is loving and compassionate and longs to pour that out on us, dear. If each and any one of us, if there's an area of our life or of our entire life that we're running from you, help us to be open to that and just turn around and let you greet us with love. And as we encounter people today on this Easter, and a time where people are more open to this love and more open to hearing about you as a church in the coming days, that just give us the opportunities to share this love. And whatever that looks like, if it's in word, just let us greet people with compassion and share the love we see portrayed in Luke 15. Come that and share a God that comes running towards them right where they're at, Lord. I ask you to bless the food that we're about to eat and the service that we'll have in the communion, and hopefully we'll have even more people that Jonathan can share his message with and what you've laid on his heart today. Bless us the rest of this Easter, and just help us to remember the empty grave, the empty grave bed that and what it means for our lives, Lord, and experience your love. All these things we ask in your name. Amen. Thank you all for coming with us and worshiping. Joe's going to go flip some pancakes for us. We have breakfast downstairs, and then we obviously have service after that. So, thank you.
Good morning, buddy.
How you doing?
Yeah, the stroller with the battery.